Grace of Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen. I know I've shared this with you before. I believe there are kind of two types of guys who end up becoming pastors. Those who kind of know it and are okay with that from a very young age, or at least when they figure it out, they're okay with it. And those who run from it, kicking and screaming, and I'm the latter. And I share that with you, knowing that there are some pastors who say, I probably shouldn't tell you that. There seems to be this piety among pastors that we have to talk a certain way, act a certain way among our people, but I'd rather be honest than pious, and so I'm sharing it with you again, because for me, there wasn't just like this one moment where it all clicked. It wasn't this great, grand story about how I figured out I wanted to be a pastor, and here we go. It took a long time. From the time I started college until the day I was installed here was 2 weeks shy of 10 years. And, you know, when you've only lived close to 30, it's a 30-year life. I tell you that because when I hear stories like our Old Testament and our gospel lesson, I want you to know that I kind of struggle with it. Because I don't have this great story, right? I didn't hear God calling me like Samuel. I didn't see Jesus. He didn't see me under a fig tree. I never sat under a fig tree. But I don't have that kind of story. And it's easy for us, like pastor types, to feel like we need one of those. But I think it's even easier for Christians to feel like they need one of those in general. Like they need this grand story about how they came to have faith, so on and so forth. I struggle with that. And when I was at the Baptist Seminary, right, now it's historically Baptist, which doesn't mean a whole lot today, but not a lot of them were baptized as infants. And if they were, they kind of got re-baptized because they thought they needed to. And I am of the opinion that that's not necessary. And so when I would have these conversations, and I would tell them, well, I was baptized as an infant, and like I was okay with it, they would look at me like I had three heads. Like, are you nuts? You've got to do something else. And so I tend to get back at them when they would ask me when I found Jesus and say, I didn't know he was missing. It's kind of Lutheran humor, right? It's a little funny, but humor became a mechanism for me to sort of defend myself against this, what I felt was a pressure to have a greater story than what I had. That I needed this grand narrative of a conversion, or I needed something bigger than what I actually have as my story, which is pretty, ordinary. I was baptized as an infant. I can't remember a time where I didn't know God was around. That's just kind of how it is from the first memories till now. That's my story. And whether they meant to or not, whether you've experienced this in the greater scheme of things or not, there tends to be an attitude that we need to have something more. And people literally pointed to texts like our Old Testament gospel lesson and said, see, God's people have had these kind of stories. You should have one too. And if you don't, maybe there's something wrong with you. Maybe there is something wrong with you, but that's not it. If we take a look at these stories, which I think we need to do, and because I'm a Lutheran, we're just going to look at the gospel and not the Old Testament, just look at what actually happened. Nathanael is sitting under a tree. Philip walks up to him and says, hey, we figured out who the guy that the Moses and the Old Testament prophets are talking about. It's this guy from Nazareth. And what's Nathanael's response? Can anything good come from Nazareth? I mean, that is supposed to be one of those sarcastic things you could ever hear in the Bible, because that's precisely how he meant it. Nazareth was pretty backward. I mean, it was like, I don't know. Anything could actually come from Nazareth? What are you guys telling me here? But indeed, right, he sees Jesus, and Jesus says some things to him about how he saw him, and Nathanael says, hey, you're the guy. You're the Son of God, the King of Israel. I mean, that's really the whole story. He's sitting under a fig tree. Jesus calls him, and he responds, "You are the Son of God." Now, what I learned from my time in the wilderness, which is the phrase I like to use from when I was at a Baptist seminary, is that every conversion story is always the same. People may change, locations may change, but at their core, all of them are like this one. Christ calls and someone confesses. That's the reality of it. Christ comes, whether it is face-to-face, the way Nathaniel had it, whether it is audibly, like Samuel had it, whether it is through the word preached or read through the waters of baptism, Christ comes to us each and every time. No one converts themselves. It is always God's work from start to finish. And it always leads somewhere. It's not just conversion for the sake of conversion. It ends with confession. And I don't mean what we did earlier. I mean, we say back to God what he has said to us. Christ says, "I'm the guy. I am the Son of God. I have come for you." And we say, "You are the Son of God. You have come for us." That's how it works. It's a little ordinary. Sometimes stories can seem a little more extraordinary, but at their core, this is how people receive faith. It's on account of what Christ does, not on account of what we do. He comes to us. He makes the first move, always, every single time. And that's something we should sit and think about for a minute. Because that's true for the infant and the elderly. For the person who can stand up here and talk about it, and the person who doesn't have the mental capacity to do so. It is the story for every single person throughout the age that has ever believed in Christ. It connects each and every one of us, regardless of our emotional or mental or physical capacity to do anything about it. This is how God works. He comes to us and we cannot but confess. Even if we can't speak, we still confess, because that's what it means to receive faith from God. You receive his gifts, and his gifts speak of what he has done. In the waters of baptism, where we were drowned and raised to new life, in, with, and under the bread and the wine, where we receive, whether we understand it or not, the very body and blood of Christ himself for us. God is always coming to us. He is always converting us. He is always bringing us to faith and communicating to the world what that actually means, which is all it means to confess. It happened for Samuel. It happened for Nathaniel. It happened for you and for me. Our stories may be a little different, but we should be never be made to feel inferior on account of the fact that some of them may sound a little more ordinary. Because all of them are ordinary, because this is how God ordinarily works. Through his Son, coming down to us, making us alive, that we might go out and confess before the world who he is and what he has done. Nathaniel, you are the Son of God. That's how it goes. God calls us, and we confess every single time. Amen.